Hello class, we've been for quite some time now. We have been focusing on forms and looking through the introduction part. We already have around two theories. But in total we have four, one that talks about form responsiveness and another one that talks about advanced form design, and then the two talking about introduction to forms. So this will be, if you may call it, the fifth, but the three-part series that talk about introduction to forms. We've already looked at the forms in general. We looked at also form attributes, we looked at form elements, we have covered input types, and now we are going to look at input attributes. There are quite a different number of input attributes. Some of them we have already covered them, so we want to be, can call this input attributes. Same thing here, CSS, so we can change this to form dash input dash attributes. Here was CSS file, CSS from input attributes. So we are going to run straight away into what we are supposed to look at. We have already seen certain attributes, one of them being value. We've already covered value, we have already covered this later about to a placeholder, but we can repeat that. We are going to repeat stuff like max length, mean, maximum, for purposes of proper understanding. We are going to look at the say multiple as an input attribute, which looks right there at pattern, and the other things. There are those we can repeat here just for emphasis, but we realize that most of them, we've covered them. We are just though there are also new ones that we did not know. For example, the first one, or we hadn't covered, the first one can be read-only. We could have our form here, and then we say that if the output, rather if the input is labeled read only, or we are using an attribute of read only on that out, on that input, then it is rendered not to be modified. You cannot modify it. The only thing you can try to do is to copy from it. You can highlight it, but you cannot write anything or adjust anything from the values or anything in that particular section. So we could have a form and a label where we say maybe this is first name, then this is first name, then will be here. We could also have input, which is text, and then this is the ID and the name. Both of these are first names. We could have set the value as Tarema. Then we can make it read only. So if it is read only, then we cannot set required. Otherwise, we arrange ourselves and unless the value. If you know that the value is already there, then why would you set required on a read only? So we can come here and change these to our last name, and the value can be Benjamin. We leave this, you can just say maybe required. Yeah, just for now, we shall use required later. We can change this now to last name. So when we open this, we find that we have this. For example, we can come here and change this person to Edwin, whereas here there is, can highlight it, but we cannot change anything. By now you would have seen something there. Even when you choose to say delete, you won't be deleting anything from that. We could do also, so it means maybe this family begins with the name say Tarima, and then the rest keep changing, just like how people these days or in other countries name their children. So that is read only, and that is how you can use it. There is another attribute that I don't like teaching in most cases, one we call disabled. Why? Because if you label an input disabled, then its input or its value will not even be submitted. So I've not yet found a proper purpose for showing the input and at the same time calling it disabled. But in cases where there is information maybe you wouldn't want sent though captured, then, but even that, the input, when you label it disabled, it is unclickable, you cannot use it. So, but it exists, you just have to come here and say disabled. So when you say disabled, this is how it looks like. For purposes of us looking at it, maybe that is how it looks like. Another attribute that we might be interested in we could go ahead and look at this. We have another input that we can define as size input attribute, but we can just show it here. Can for example come here and say that the size that is read only, we can come here and say that size is maybe, let's say that this last name should hold certain characters. We can just say 10 characters. The idea here would have been that we want to limit the number of characters to that input, but that does not work very well with the size. If we come back here and then, so we could say 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11 12, you can see we are exceeding the size we set. Even if we had something else, assuming we had say another input here, we could have another input. Let's say this input can be say like your mobile pin or like the ATM pin. You can say a pin, a for ATM, and then this would mean can be text or can be number, but number it means somebody is just going to click. I don't have any value. 5 digits or 4, we could just say 5. So if then we can come here and say ATM pin. So when we come and say 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8, you can see it is not giving us what we want as size, but if that is for the width. But if we had, we looked at another example of size where we had a selection and options, and then we said size, so that would give us the height or the number of items in that particular selection that you would want displayed for the user by default. So that way, by default, you would say I want two options displayed. Another time you could say that I want four, because the default is one. So the best way to use that is using another attribute called the max length. Max and minimum length would work literally the same way. So you could come here, set max length to be 10. Even when you have a size of 10, here you could say max length, and this would be 5. So when we come here at the pin 1 2 3 4 5 6, the 6 cannot get in. Why? Because we said that the maximum should be 5. If these are 10 and they are saying 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 8 9 10 11 11, cannot get in because we said that the maximum should be a maximum should be 10. So that is the correct way of actually forcing a user not to exceed a certain limit of characters. You usually see they are saying that this input, or somewhere they can say input up to 32 characters or 20, depending on what somebody has decided to do. Another one is minimum and maximum attributes. We also looked at them quite a number of times in the tutorial introduction to forms part 2, where we are looking at input types. We looked at these, where we could use them on numbers, we could use them on date, we could use them on, can use them even on month, time. We even had an example of comparing how to create a time limit, the minimum and the maximum time set. So that when you can check part 2, you will see how we used it, introduction to forms part 2. Another one is multiple, and this is usually used with two input types, email and file. This usually is when a user wants to put in or to capture more than one item or one input for that particular input part. So you can say, we could come here and maybe say your files for user files. Then we can come here and say your files 80. Then we have this as, let's say select file, select, okay, we can leave it as a file, select, or we can say select file. Maybe to tell somebody that you can actually select more than one, you can put that in brackets. Let us change this to an attribute of file, such that we have a customized one. You can see it here. So if we have, say, can look into our document and maybe see where we have all these other virus, and then we can see how to pick them. If we said choose fire, all you need to do now is press the hold down the control button, or for those with the Mac you can simply use the command, and that one will be able to work it for you. Just simple files. Okay, we can get this. Press the control button and I get this. Just come here. We have not declared multiple as an attribute to the input to make sure it informs this file section that we want to select more than one. That is why you couldn't see it work. So we can come here on CSS and then pick this. Now you can see us highlighting two files by simply adding multiple, and you can see it update that these are two files and their name is there, which is quite important. We could also, we looked at yesterday a pattern. Even when you check in advanced form design, you will see how to use an attribute called pattern. That is the easiest way to find it, but we can look at just a quick example. We could have these two. And then we could say, can call this one here. Maybe zip code. Here and say enter zip code. So this can just be text where we expect the numbers and the other characters, but we can limit that by saying pattern, and pattern will here define how we want this. For example, we can choose to say that we only want text, not a mixture of characters and numbers and text, because that would be regarded as text also. But we could say, for example, we can say we only want values that have A to Z, capital A to Z, okay? And we also can take small A to small Z. So that one there, we are not limiting you to use capital letters, and we expect to say it is a this pattern length can be maximum three. So, but if we say this, and we are picking whether it is capital or not, then we can come here and say maybe UGX for Uganda, for example, depends on say USA, meaning you will have to abbreviate others. You can see then capital letters can accept. If it was a mixture, then we would have allowed 0 to 9. We can come here and say 0 to 9. And then maybe, okay, 0 to 9. then we expect this one here now, when we can set our pattern there, saying pattern, this can be number, because when we leave it as text, then we are going to have very many issues. So with it, changing it to number and even forcing it on the pattern, text cannot get in. You can put in a number between 0 and 9, because it is inclusive, all these other numbers come from 0 and 9. And say, so that is what we are interested in. We could, if they were going to be maybe a mixture, even with here, setting text, and then we could have left it as text, but even when you say text and then do not force the pattern to be text only, then it will accept other numbers and characters, so you have opened it. So if it is going to be text entirely, then all you have to do is to declare them, to declare the pattern as text. Then that way you are sure that anything that enters here is strictly text, and that we do not expect numbers to interfere with what we want. Something like that. So the next one, we've already used it, but we can try it out. For a placeholder, and it works with many types apart from say date and time and month and week. It works with other ranges like text, it works with the password, email, telephone number, URL, and simply a placeholder is just something here that we can add on without writing any other code. Placeholder, and then we say enter your zip code. So one thing you also need to know, can you see the words here, that the placeholder sometimes defines this particular input area comprehensively compared to the label. The label could just be zip code. Here you can place, you can choose to tell it that this pattern here, or you can even pick a placeholder for the pattern that it must be, that it must look like that, and then the person will know that this is what is expected of me, that is what they are telling me to do. So it doesn't have to be everything, you can just show it here. It is accepting capital letters and small letters from A to Z, because that way we shall have made sure that the only thing we can accept are characters. There is another attribute we can use here, and one that we looked at the required, we can maybe try it a little bit, and it is almost on every attribute apart from the funny ones of hidden, but you will use it on almost all of them. could be date pickers, time, file, radio checkbox, password, email, tally, URL, all the other inputs. Because if it is hidden and you don't want it displayed or tampered with, then there is nothing a user can do. So when you have, for example, when you say required, then someone must put in that information. Can say required. Okay, we can leave that like that. And then we have another one here. Can just copy this and paste them down here. And we say that this is required. This is required. And if it is required, then we have here, we could say password. We could say your password for you, for user. We can change this type to password, where we shall have asterisks. We can put here password. We could then put here put placeholder, enter password. We could have something else. We did this in another tutorial, especially of two, introduction to forms two. Then we can simply come here and say confirm. Confirm password, and then this we can change to see confirm user password. You can change this to confirm. I'm trying to be as realistic as possible, because that is when it becomes helpful. So we can look at what we have. They are here. Password, confirm password. The statistics are there working. So in case we have submit button here, can either use input or we can just say submit, and then value is what the text is, submit. So when we have such a button and we try to submit this page, we can see that it is informing us that please fill out this field by default, because we said it is required. Even if we came here on pin and said required, and then we put in say password, and then we say file, can you please fill out this field. The same applies to coming here and saying where was it? There was ATM here on file, can you see. So placeholders can be used almost everywhere. But the same applies to this. Can you see? Same applies to all these. Even if I was to put in a pin, and then here, and then here, and I try to submit, then so it first checks the form to make sure everything that is needed for you to submit is so. There is another one we looked at, it called step. You could use numbers, you could use ranges. We can come here. Last time we used ranges, so now we can just look at the number. For example, we could come here and say, label. points. I can have an input here. And since it is a number, and say ID, we say name, and then we can adjust this all at once. We can call that B points. So when we check out our label, this is how it is going to be. Going to the negatives, going to the positives. You could now choose, for example, at first to say max or minimum is equal to, minimum is equal to 0. You can say maximum is equal to 50. Yeah, you can even say 30. So with that, we set where it needs to be. Then we can come and apply our step if you want. So the step will be telling us what or how many characters or numbers would you want to jump. Okay, so we can could cut this once again. We can say minimum is 1. So we could say step and come here and say step. Since we are stopping at 30, we could say every time we click, it would do a 1. We can make it be say 11, 11. Can just put it near, say 12, and because here when we say 1 and we say 3, the next one will be 4, the next one will be 7, next one will be 10. We can make this 13, such that we have something better to work with. So we could come here and say, can see 4, 7, 10, 13, and that was our maximum. We could come here and this was our minimum value. So that is minimum and maximum, and also step and another input type called number. But we've already looked at all these. I'm sure it is not new. Another one that is very sweet is what we call autofocus. In most cases, you usually see it happen, but you maybe never know why it is like that. For example, we can just come here and say autofocus. Focus. What this does is that if that page is open, then by default that particular input you have decided to give autofocus attribute to, then is automatically selected. You see it here. But if we are crazy and we have 2 autofocuses, what does it do? Sometimes I have to think crazy like that. So it picks the first one. Okay, picks the first one, put in pin like that maybe, and then it is saying you have not, since it was going to submit, you have not chosen this file. So that is autofocus. That if a page loads, that particular section you want a user to start with is put into focus, or the cursor takes itself there very fast. We have looked at height and width for an image, and it is important that in most cases when you are using images on your page, you define those images, you define their height and width. Why do we need to do that? Because then as the page loads, the browser knows that there is a certain image that is supposed to be loaded, and it is occupying this kind of space, and then your space is saved. If you do not do that, then automatically the browser will just load, and as it loads, it meets pages, and then you will see your documents rearranging themselves. But if the width and height are set, the browser knows that at beforehand that I am expecting an image, and it is of this size. We can maybe look at the, see if we can get a small image here, one that we can use. But as we looked at list attribute, where we use it with, together with the a data list, and these simply create predefined values. You already have values that you must use, so to that extent it is okay. And usable like that, so you want to look at it, you can check in the, in one of our tutorials, we have it there that we can use. We are saying that we could have a label here, we can say images, and we can call this we can call that an image. Now we could just use it differently as an input type without a label, even can say input image. That will save us some time. We have an ID here. We could use it here in case we ever want to particularly pick it out, and it is a special one. We'd pick it like that. You never know when you want to apply, say, JavaScript to this. The most important thing here we are looking for is the source, and we put it in images. It will say we can pick logo, and now we have width, which can be like say 50. We have height, that is also 50. So when we are doing like this, we don't need to use pixels, those are for CSS. We could maybe put an alternative text that this image was for submit, and in that manner can have something like this here. That is how it looks like, our image. I think then we need a BR here, BR here. To do away with this label, come and find this our thing. So because we are saying we can have an image of that nature, and this image would also work like the submit button, We looked at autocomplete, and those would be our email, our attributes, our input attributes. There are several other attributes that we looked at. Check out the tutorial, Introduction to Forms Part 1, where we looked at form attributes. And that will be all for today.